tradition continues with a college basketball classic. It's Duke and North Carolina meeting for the 205th time. The tip from the Dean Dome is next. ESPN2's exclusive presentation of NCAA basketball presented by America Online is brought to you by the Pontiac Sunfire, hot set of wheels, money left to burn.
America Online new version 5.0.
Tar-Heel game programs right here.
Go Tar-Heel!
Welcome to the Smith Center in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, for the 205th edition of college basketball's greatest rivalry. A fiery coach with two warriors who embody his spirit. They've engineered an unprecedented ride of dominance in a demanding conference. Invigorated by a new wave of muscle, desire, and talent, together they have a future that burns bright. Rewind to almost 2 years ago to the day when a stable of thoroughbreds soared, twirled, and whirled, unleashing their unbridled power and stuffing Duke with a swagger that fueled the frenzy of Carolina Blue. But of late, seemingly seeking the proper direction, struggling and staggering to unexpected lows, and seemingly boxed in. They had to endure the end of a streak, knocked down but not out. Underneath, there's wounded pride, and there's an NC on the chest. Welcome to the Dean Smith Center in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. America Online brings you Rivalry Week. It's Duke at 16-2 against North Carolina at 13-8. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick along with Dick Vitale. It's great to have you with us. Duke loses its first two games of the season, then runs off 16 in a row. North Carolina starts slowly, but they're looking better, and this is the game that could turn their entire season around.
I tell you, Mike, you talk about a statement game. You talk about a game of urgency to silence all the critics. Bill Guthridge's club's got to gut it up and win a big game. Even their star player, Mr. Cable, said, we haven't won a big game yet this year. Losing to Indiana, losing, for example, to Cincinnati, and now they get a chance. 6 miles up the road, here comes the Dukies, and they need this W.
Duke is a great team. They've won 16 straight, but they bring three freshmen in here. Will that make a difference in this building?
I'll tell you, Mike, you talk about the three diaper dandies. The one thing they got going for them is they got a great combination. Certainly a Mr. Carroll and Mr. Battier. I believe they're the best 1-2 punch in America who understands the art of winning. They just do it all. They really are very versatile. They defend well. They rebound, and they score. But, Mr. Daugherty, this game might be decided right in the trenches by a freshman, Carlos Boozer, and a big guy, Mr. Haywood.
I think you're absolutely right, Dick. I think it's going to be an interesting battle inside. Carlos Boozer, 6'9", 260 pounds. He brings a lot of force to the basket, uses both hands very well, plays in the athletic position. He gets fouled a lot, and he finishes a lot on those foul attempts. One thing he does not do is block a lot of shots, but he is strong, ground-bound, and he pushes and shoves, holds position very well. Conversely, you go to Brendan Haywood, who is starting to emerge as that dominant inside player that North Carolina's been looking for since the beginning of the season. Shooting 70% from the floor, he's really starting to be explosive. He has very good hands, can finish around the basket. It's going to be a well of a matchup inside. Back to you, Mike.
All right, thank you, Brad. Let's get the starting lineups. Public address announcer, Kearney Andrews.
Good evening and welcome to the University of North Carolina's Dean E. Smith Center. Tonight, the Tar Heels are pleased to host the Blue Devils of Duke University. Here are the starters for tonight's game. For the Blue Devils, coached by Mike Krzyzewski. At forward, number 23, a 6'6 senior from St. Louis, Missouri, Chris Carrawell. At forward, number 31, a 6'8 junior from Birmingham, Michigan, Shane Battier. At center, number 4, a 6'9 freshman from Juneau, Alaska, Carlos Boozer. The guards are number 14, a 6'6 junior from Washington, D.C., Nate James. And number 22, a 6'2 freshman from Plainfield, New Jersey, Jason Williams. And starting for the Tar Heels, coached by Bill Guthridge. At the forwards, number 42, a 6'11 sophomore from Gastonia, Chris Lang. And number 25, a 6'8 sophomore from Chesapeake, Virginia, Jason Capel. At center, double zero, a 7-foot junior from Greensboro, Brendan Haywood. At the guards, number 40, a 6'4 freshman from Greenbelt, Maryland, Joseph Forte. And number 5, a 6'2½ senior from Brooklyn, Ed Cota.
Duke and North Carolina coming up from the Dean Smith Center back after this. This is Rivalry Week, presented by America Online. Duke against North Carolina. And, Dick, let's take a look at the Ramada matchups for tonight.
Well, you take a look at a matchup right here. Carroll will probably start out on Forte, but I really believe you'll see his versatility go to Ed Cota. I also think when you look at Chris Carroll, he's one of the real outstanding defensive players because he can guard inside people and outside people. Eventually, he will put the pressure on Mr. Cota. And then we talk about the front court matchups. And when you talk about the front court matchups, Mr. Battier is the best defensive player in America. We'll see Boozer start out in Haywood, but eventually Mr. Battier will be right over in that area. Mr. Battier and Mr. Carroll are the anchors of the Duke defense.
We are set to go. Duke Etzel will toss it up. He'll work the game with Steve Gordon and Bob Donato. And Duke controls the opening tip. Battier gives it up to the freshman, Jason Williams.
Man-to-man defense right now by North Carolina. But I really believe, Mike, we're going to see a lot of 2-3 matchup out of North Carolina.
Carroll knocks into the corner for Nate James, who has not shot the ball well lately, but he buried that one.
I'll tell you, Mike Krzyzewski told me before the game, he said, an unsung hero, a guy that does a lot of the little things and doesn't get any kind of notoriety.
Lang outside. This is Capel. Watch for that matchup inside with those big guys. Instead, it's the running jumper for 2, and it's 1-point lead for Duke.
Man-to-man defense. I know we're going to see a lot of zone defense because I don't believe they have the quickness, Mike, to really play Duke one-on-one.
Battier over Lang, and he drills it.
I tell you, they came out firing right now. I mean, you talk about the teams, a lot of intensity, a lot of emotion. Seem very relaxed shooting the basketball.
Great pass inside. Haywood has it stripped on the way up, but Battier was standing on the end line.
You know, Brendan Haywood shooting 71%. He leads the nation in field goal percentage. But you and I talked about driving over here. The bottom line is, as you look at Haywood on the inside, he's got to get more touches, Mike. He only averages 7 shots a game. I believe for them to win tonight, he's got to take at least 12 shots.
And they've got to get him in position to get those shots. Cota gets it inside to Lang. So quick off his feet, but short with that jumper.
He's had such a tough year, Lang, physically, stamina problems.
Williams all the way underneath. Carroll will try a 3. This is where North Carolina should have the advantage on the boards.
That's a concern of Mike Krzyzewski rebounding.
Bad pass by Cota. Here comes Duke the other one.
North Carolina's had a problem with turnovers, averaging 20 turnovers approximately in those 4 games they lost in a row and didn't force many turnovers.
Jason Williams, the freshman, still learning the point guard position. Little turnaround jump shot is good. Duke hot early. Carroll hits another one.
I tell you, as he stepped up to be the number one option, you can see that he wants the basketball. From Cardinal Ritter High School in St. Louis, he has become a man.
He's had 8 games with 20 or more. Cota can't get the roll on the jumper. Just hung on the rim, wouldn't fall for it. And that's what they want Cota to do, take that outside shot. Duke in a hurry to put it up, long rebound. Good hustle by Capel. Tries to take it end to end, and it's swiped.
They got numbers right now. Center to basketball.
Blocked as Boozer tried to take it inside.
Good defensive transition by North Carolina. One of their weaknesses all year has been quickness, giving up a lot of points in transition.
Awful pass that time by Capel. Third turnover so far for the Heels. Nate James. Offensive rebound to Boozer. Won't go. And a foul. Let's see who picks it up.
Capel with the foul on the interior. Mike, Duke became a better basketball team when they got a healthy Carlos Boozer. He gave them presence inside. And you have to have inside presence to be effective, to have balance. Let's go to our guy, Brad Daugherty. Brad Daugherty, you take a look at Boozer's game. He has given him some post presence.
Yeah, you're exactly right, Dick. Carlos is very strong. And the thing I like about Carlos Boozer is he plays the game with his knees bent at all times. Watch him in the post. He's always down in that athletic position that you like to see the big guys get into. Look at him right now. He's already bent down, ready to defend.
I'll tell you, look at those numbers, Mike. They've jumped big time, doubled the last 11 games.
Had a broken bone in his left foot in August that got him off to a slow start. That last foul called against Duke. It was on Nate James, his first and the team's first. Cota dumps it down to Capel. His baseline jumper won't go. And thrown away by the Blue Devils, out to North Carolina.
So much pressure on North Carolina offensively in their half-court game because they don't get a lot of easy baskets in transition. They almost have to score with each possession. So execution becomes vital to North Carolina.
They lead the nation in field goal percentage at 50.7. But you're right, Dick. They have to shoot that well to have a chance. They've had three turnovers and only hit one out of five baskets so far. There's a tough shot that won't go. As Julius Peppers into the ballgame for the first time tries to score.
Well, the football player, I'll tell you one thing. He's so aggressive. As you look at Lang sitting on the sideline, Carolina 1-for-6 out of the start.
Peppers has given them a lift when he comes in. Very smart basketball player.
Yeah, Mike Krzyzewski said he tried to recruit him a little bit when he was in high school. Very active, good football player. All-American as a freshman in terms of freshman class with other freshmen in Sporting News.
Forte pulls up for three. He's short. The Heels ice cold to start. But they're only down by five.
Not really getting good shots in their offensive set. Not getting enough ball movement.
And here's finally a foul away from the ball as Haywood was being muscled inside, and it's going to be on Christensen.
See, Christensen
to pick up his first.
Yeah, he's got five fouls to give, and he's just going to lay a body on him. He's physical. He's definitely made contact there. He's a space eater on the interior, just on a court that really gives him some physical presence.
Actually came to school in the fall of 95, played a little bit as a freshman, and then went on a Mormon mission, then sat out a medical redshirt year.
He's been around a while.
He has, he's still only sophomore.
Wow.
And this one's going to go in the backcourt, touched by North Carolina. Another turnover, their fourth against only one made basket. 15:49 to go, first half. Duke with the early lead, 7-2 here at North Carolina, Dick.
Well, you know, Duke really is great, Mike, at really attacking the basket. Dribble penetration is one of their keys offensively. Look at the free throws made, 344, and their opponents have only attempted 289. That is an unbelievable plus. Plus, they shoot 75% approximately on the line. Six of their players, their top six, shoot better than 72%. And then on the other side, North Carolina, as you said earlier, really turning the ball over early in this game. Four turnovers already. Look here in their four consecutive losses. 72 turnovers. I mean, that's unbelievable. And they only forced 43. The bottom line is, if you're doing that, that puts pressure to execute offensively.
They used to lead in turnovers all the time because they used to be able to take that trapping defense out and force other people into mistakes. They can't do that anymore. They don't have all the athletes they need to run that defense.
They don't have that kind of quickness. You know, early in this game, 10 possessions, they've only got 2 points, and Haywood's only got one shot. Here comes the zone. I thought we'd see the zone, the matchup. They played it really aggressively against Maryland in the second half and against Georgia Tech.
Tough pass there, saved by Battier. He's double-teamed, kicks it back outside, and Williams will be short on the jump shot.
He's capable of knocking that shot down, a streaky shooter.
Good defensive transition by Duke, getting back, making it a 5-on-5 game.
Max Owens in for the first time. This is Cota penetrating, but missing, and the rebound goes to Christensen.
If they're going to win this game, Cota's got to really step up offensively like he did against North Carolina State. He went 8-for-8 in that game.
That was the first time he was able to get inside, and this foul on Julius Peppers as he cut off Battier on the baseline.
And there's an example of dribble attack, and that is Duke basketball. Beat the guy with the dribble to the basket and make something happen off dribble penetration.
Boozer will come back in the ball game, and Christensen gave him a couple of good minutes off the bench.
I'll tell you one thing Duke does well is shoot the basketball. So the zone, if they get in gaps, they can get some good shots.
This will be a foul as well. Rivalry Week presented by America Online continues Saturday on ESPN2 at 7 p.m. when the Louisville Cardinals, led by forwards Nate Johnson and Tony Williams, take on the Memphis Tigers and Memphis native Marcus Moody. For more, log on to ESPN.com, part of GoNetworkGo.com.
Well, you know, rumors are circulating big time, Mike, that John Calipari's been offered that job down in Memphis. Be a big question whether he takes it, but I really believe Calipari will be back in college next year. They usually make those. They shoot better than 74%. They come up empty on a free throw line.
North Carolina, as poorly as it has shot, still down by only 5.
Williams and Cota going head to head.
Capel hits the 3. Jason Capel, a 40% shooter from long range. He doesn't have enough to qualify among the league leaders, but he's dangerous.
I tell you, that's a big basket for Capel because in big games, he's had some tough moments.
Battier wheels into a triple team. Great defense by North Carolina.
And yeah, did a good job. They're running the ball up the court.
Pull up jumper, and it's Capel again.
And that is big news. In Cincinnati and in Indiana, he went 1-for-9 and 0-for-9. So with him stepping up in a big game, that's giving this crowd a big lift here, baby, in Chapel Hill.
We are tied at 7, and that zone has been such a big help for this ball club. Dunleavy clanks one off the glass, but what a rebound by Battier.
Battier hanging around the glass. Dunleavy's an outstanding shooter, but it didn't look on that shot, Mike. That was Brick City, USA.
That's one of the freshmen you talked about. He's got to get warmed up in a hostile environment.
Well, his dad was quite a player at South Carolina. 5-second violation. 5-second count.
Cota too closely guarded, and they turn it over again. That's 5.
We're going to see the big football player right here lay a screen, and he's going to come right off that screen. Now, right there, you see the screen? Here it is. Freeze it. Right there. He lays the screen for his buddy, and now he's got the shot right here. Yes, sir. Mr. Peppers, the football player, says, I'm going to give my body up.
Duke trying to get some penetration on his zone. Dunleavy, a lot of contact, no whistle, bucket counts.
And even Bill Guthridge, who's normally very quiet. Look at the intensity on the sideline of Bill Guthridge. Look at the emotion. Tell me he doesn't want this game. He knows this is a statement game. This is a game of urgency for North Carolina's program.
And he certainly thought he had an offensive foul there. Nice drive down the lane by Max Owens.
He goes up and down, Mike, just like some of the stocks you and your machine today running around with all your stock quotes. He's like that, baby, up and down.
Owens had scored only 26 points in his last 6 ball games. They need him to score coming off the bench.
He showed so much potential at the end of the year last year.
And here is the technical against North Carolina.
Wow. The normally very quiet, stoic Mr. Guthridge gets hit with a T. You know what? I think that's good. I think that's sending a message to his kids that I'm a fighter too, and that I'm going to fight for you here today. It's early in the game, Mike. It can't hurt them big time here.
I think it was a message he was upset with a call, too.
Yes, sir. But he's normally so quiet. He's a lot like I am, you know, very serene.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of similarities between you two guys.
Hey, Brad,
except for the hairstyle, that's about it.
Hey, Brad, I want to ask you, you played for Bill Guthridge. Are you a little surprised seeing his emotion?
Well, usually Coach Guthridge doesn't let his emotion spill out, but don't be fooled. There's a fire that burns in Bill Guthridge like no other I've ever seen. He's a very intense man, and he had a very good reason to argue that point. Whenever you have your center 7 foot in the middle of a zone take a charge, that's pretty special.
It's his first technical ever as a head coach.
I think the zone is a great decision. Even if Duke hits some shots against it, it protects Haywood. It keeps him around the basket for rebounding ability.
Boozer tried to get inside, had it blocked. Battier with a follow. The problem with Duke, they have six guys in double figures. To stop one, there's five other guys you can throw.
It's great when you got that kind of balance. They play a lot of minutes. You wonder about fatigue in close games down the stretch, but it didn't hurt them at NC State or Virginia, where they pulled both those games out in overtime.
And they don't have many of those, do they? Forte a bad pass, but Cota saved it, and then Cota tries a runner. Lang with a foul. They thought he was fouled, then Lang makes sure nobody stops.
He said, I'm up dead tonight. I'm not hurting tonight, baby. This is Duke. I'm ready to play. The best rivalry in all of college sports.
15-11. Duke on top by four. Farrell and Battier. Now they go to the freshman Boozer.
Good ball movement. You want to use the skip pass also.
Battier, nice fake, and it got Hayward up in the air.
Well, they do a great job on the inside. You can see people work with their players on post moves on the interior. Great head fake, ball fake to get the opportunity to go to the line. They're going to take a look at Mr. Lang. Listen to Mr. Lang. He says, once I don't have it, second time I got it, a jam.
Last foul on Hayward was his first. Normally, you don't see him leave his feet. He's a very smart shot blocker, and Battier was the best free throw shooter in the ACC at above 84%. Now has 9 points and three rebounds already in this ball game.
I tell you, they set the tone. Carwell and Battier set the tone for the young people not to be intimidated. And they have stepped up as offensive players because last year, Mike, they were fourth and fifth options with guys like Elton Brand and Langdon and company when you saw that club last season.
Battier just so smooth, he has given Duke a six-point lead. Duke on top of North Carolina, 17-11, 11:44 to go first half. Dick, you're going to have to say what week this is. I'm having trouble with it. I've already said it about eight times.
What's it called, rivalry week?
Thank you.
I got it. Oh, wow. Take a look at some of these rivals right here. What a great game that Tennessee game was with UConn.
Wasn't it?
The women's game was sensational. And Michigan State won easily over Michigan. Syracuse, are they legitimate? I tell you, this club is so legitimate. Jimmy Boeheim deserves to have the court named after him. He bleeds. I mean, he bleeds Syracuse orange.
Cota trying to penetrate.
They've done a good job cutting off his penetration. They really
have. They did last year, too. They played like a half a step back off of him. Still put some pressure on him, but not let him inside. Haywood, way out of position, gives it to Forte. Shot clock approaching 10. Got it back to Haywood, and he powers it in.
Whenever he touches the ball inside, usually something positive happens. As we said, he leads the nation 71%.
That's the fifth time he's got his hands on it, his first 2 points.
I like him in that three-second area, though. I think he does a great job plugging that hole up.
Crowd wanted another foul inside as Lang and Battier are going after each other.
A lot of patience. I tell you, talk about a maturity process. Jason Williams really matured as a point guard, learning what a point guard does in a Duke system.
Shot clock is down to three. Williams tries, got caught under the basket, had to throw it out underneath. Well, he made a freshman error that time.
Well, interesting matchup. Williams out of New Jersey, Cota from out of New York.
Excellent defense that time by Christensen. He just stood his ground and wouldn't let Haywood get inside.
And that's all they wanted out of Christensen, to play some defense, take some space inside. You know, growing up as a kid, Williams said back in October, I played against Ed Cota. I was in the eighth grade. He was a senior, and he whipped on me, and he was talking trash. And Carroll grabbed him and said, hey, don't talk. Don't start any kind of stuff like that. And he came back. He said, you know what? He's a great player.
Travel on Nate James. And just like most seniors against eighth graders, Cota doesn't remember it.
Right, that's right. As a cook at Coach Krzyzewski, did he roll his sleeves up this year after losing the players he lost and go to work and come back? Because a lot of people thought Duke would be in a rebuilding situation.
Sure. They just did a remarkable job. Not only does he go out and get a great recruiting class, but he coaches them to the point where they're now number three in the nation. They've won 16 in a row, 29 in a row in the ACC. Now, that's a heck of a job.
And 45 in a row at home. They got Virginia coming in there on Saturday, and Virginia's got some good young players.
Forte running off the screen. Haywood a little too far out for him, but not for Wang. Didn't get the roll, but it's tipped in. Nice job that time by Forte. It's a good rebound.
You know, Forte's been very quiet thus far in the game, but he comes up with the big tip, and you're right, Mike. He gives him another dimension from the perimeter. There's that zone.
Push on Haywood. That will be two on Brendan. And that's a big call because he fouls Christensen, a guy who averages 2 points a game.
Yeah, he's no threat to score whatsoever. You don't want to give a foul up like that. Remember, he got in foul trouble against Georgia Tech, played with three fouls, and dominated. But in this game here, this could be a little different. You don't want him on a sideline.
Off the inbounds play, Williams knocks it down.
It's nice when you got those kids that can knock down a trifecta.
20 to 15, Duke. Duke looks so composed.
Played with a lot of poise for a bunch of young people, but I really believe it's the catalyst. Battier and Carwell rubs that off on the young kids.
Capel tries a circus shot inside.
Silly foul.
The rebound, and you're right. Capel commits the foul after Battier easily got the rebound.
Well, there's no way you're going to get away with that. The ref is staring at you. You mug the guy. You hug him. How could you possibly get away with that? Now, take a look right here out of Capel. There's Jason, his brother Jeff, as we all know, played for Duke. Here he is. He misses the shot. And now look at this. I mean, that's a tackle, Mike. That's a tackle. I mean, he's ready for the World Federation Wrestling. Get that guy Rick Lilliff, what's a flair? I mean, it's unbelievable.
I figured you would be the one guy up on your wrestling. Capel picks up his second personal. You'd look good in a ring, you know?
You know who really knows the wrestling? He's going to be mad I say
I know a lot
probably.
Of guys who'd like to see in a ring.
But I'm going
to
tell you this. You know who really knows wrestling? You will believe it all, buddy. Brad Ness.
Is
he
that
follows
right?
It. He could tell you every wrestler from 20 years ago.
20 to 15. The lead is five. Julius Peppers.
Man-to-man defense. Having a tough time getting any dribble penetration against the Duke defense. Picking up your dribbles, a no-no.
Get it inside to Lang. Puts it up with the left hand. There's Battier again.
Bad angle right there. Didn't have
oh,
a good
check
angle.
It. That was Boozer. And Duke on a roll as Williams comes down and hits a 15-footer.
Somebody better tell that kid he's a diaper dandy, that he's playing on a road. He's playing in Chapel Hill. He's as calm, cool, and collected.
There's a brick.
Really putting pressure on North Carolina to score with their possessions in their half-court game.
Battier with a three. James tries to keep it alive and did, but they're going to call Nate James, I believe, for a push-off.
See, take a look at Jason Williams. He's got the great body strength, and he has the unique ability as a point guard where he can score. There he is pulling up. St. Joe's Metuchen out of New Jersey. Mr. Howard Garfinkel told me from Five Star he was going to be a star, and oh, is he going to be a star.
He averaged almost 15 points a game as a freshman.
He's matched really what Avery did there last year.
Absolutely. Cota gets a screen. He's open. He's got a mismatch. Instead, he takes a set shot for a three. Foul won't go. Here's Lang. He's stripped on the way up and fouled by Boozer.
Well, you know, Lang is showing that he's active, and that's the real big plus for North Carolina, that he's attacking the glass. Hey, Brad, we look at Lang today, and he looks a little bit more active than we've seen him in the past.
You know, Dick, he's gotten better as the games have gone on. He's gotten his strength back, and as each game progresses, he gets a little stronger. He still gets a little tired at the end of the basketball game, though, and that'll be a big factor at the end of this game today.
Hey, Brad, I want to tell you this. I'm sorry, but I don't. Maybe you can't hear this. I'll just tell it to Mike. Hey, Mike, I don't want Brad to hear this. He's no longer one of the top guys' field goal percentage. That Mr. Haywood's got 71% is better than he was
still
when he played here.
Still number three all time.
Know,
and in all all due respect to Brendan Haywood, Brad's range was a little deeper, wasn't it, Brad?
As statistics
I
don't.
Shot a little bit deeper shots, but as long as he continues to hit those shots, I don't mind at all.
Duke on the run. They get two more out of that. It's 24 to 15. The lead's been extended to nine.
And Carwell again in transition, showing his versatility. He can rebound. He can defend.
Here's a push as Forte tried to get inside. They'll call that one on Carwell. That's one on Carwell.
You know, it's amazing thus far in this game as we've seen 12 minutes already in the game have elapsed, and Carwell has shut down Joseph Forte. He has shut him down. Here goes Mr. Carwell, the best player in the ACC. There he is with a little kiss on the glass.
Duke is on a 7-0 run. They've taken a 24-15 lead over North Carolina with only 7:49 to go in the half. Here's the summary. North Carolina, the leader of the nation in field goal percentage, shooting only 35% from the floor. They've turned it over 7 times, and even though they have nearly twice as many rebounds, they are trailing in this ball game. And 2 of the reasons, Cota, 2 assists and 3 turnovers. He's not hit a field goal. And Haywood has no rebounds and 2 points. Those are the 2 guys that have to play well for North Carolina to win.
And if they don't play well, certainly Joseph Forte, the diaper dandy's got to step up. But Chris Carawan has really locked him up early in this game.
Dick, I think if those 2 guys don't play well, then Forte's got to get 30, and so does Capel. And I don't think both of them are going to get 30.
Wow. It also has taken the crowd right out of the game. This crowd was really pumped up to give him a big lift, but Duke's early start has taken his crowd and silenced them.
Duke has come in, played very poised.
Played with a lot of poise, a lot of ball movement.
Williams with a miss. The long rebound kicked out to Dunleavy. Good job by Horvath to keep it alive.
Nice.
Williams, what a pass!
I mean, look at that. Oh, what great vision by this kid. I mean, he has got great talent and great ability, but he was a scoring guard in high school who's adjusting to the role of the point guard.
4th in the ACC in assists, and Mike Krzyzewski said we just have to let him make his mistakes and learn how to play. Owens with another miss way short off the iron.
You know what's really missing out of North Carolina? They've always had a swagger, a certain strut. You don't see that. Even in the layup drills, you don't see that swagger. And that comes with confidence.
6:46 to go, first half to play. The lead has grown to 11 points.
A lot of patience, a lot of poise by Duke. And it's amazing when you see these young kids coming right out of high school. But remember, Mike, these kids were the blue chip of the blue chip. I mean, they were superstars in high school.
Not only talented, they are smart. 1 on the shot clock. Battier had to force it and missed. A rare mistake by Duke to let the shot clock go down that far. Wide open, Cota. Can't hit
close. Not even close, Mike. He's not even close tonight.
And you saw him hesitate on that shot. It is not what he wants to do, and it's not what this offense needs.
His game is really running a break in transition, finding open people. But unfortunate for him, he doesn't have the likes of a Carter and a Jameson running the break.
Horvath, another freshman, will take the jumper.
Not a good look right there by Horvath.
Forte on the run, back to Cota. Got it inside to Lang. Lang lost it. Duke on the break. Dunleavy.
Little jam. Might need a T.O., baby. Might need a T.O. Might regroup this club.
11-0 run, and it's 28-15. Haywood not in the ball game. They get Peppers in there along with Lang. Owens with a left hand, and that breaks the streak.
He's got scoring ability. Nice move by Owens against the defense, because the defense has really taken North Carolina out of any kind of rhythm.
Haywood will be back in at the next opportunity.
Right in the gap. See, they want to attack the seams of that zone.
Carawell, under defensive pressure, has it knocked away, and it's out of bounds to Duke with 16 on the shot clock.
I tell you, Duke does as well as anybody in America. Take the ball from the defensive end and transition and convert. There's the deflection in the post. We see the deflection, and now we see them up the court. It's unbelievable. Now look how they kick out. Freeze it right there. See this right here? Beat these 2 guys, and up we go for the layup.
Williams, sensational pass. Battier wide open. He drains it. Battier has a dozen, and the lead is back to 13. Jason Capel outside. Cota again, left all alone. Finally hits one. Got the 3.
He's got to get going, because they're looking for his senior leadership. And where you show senior leadership is by the way you perform.
Ed Cota has hit 1 out of 5. The crowd back to its feet. 22,000 strong here at the Dean Dome.
They went down 11 to Maryland and came back and won that game. And the students played a big part, because the students were right on the court. That was the game, the snow game, where they made the kids sit downstairs.
Christensen travel.
This is a chance that they can get a big run right here. Hey, Brad, I want to go to Brad down inside. Brad, you were a great post player. What can Brendan Haywood do to get free down in the interior?
Dick, he's having a really tough time because teams are sending two and three guys down into his lap. What he has to do is use his other big guy, set picks for one another, play off of him.
What a move by Julius Peppers. Right-hand drive switches to the left.
I tell you, he looked like a big-time performer right there. Very athletic. And look at the Chapel Hill game. They're making like the Cameron Crazies. They're trying to go bananas. They say, let's go Heels.
The defensive end, who had 50 tackles and six sacks, gets a bucket. 30-22, the third-ranked Blue Devils on top of homestanding North Carolina by 8, 3:55. To go first half of play.
Take a look at these streaks, Mike. 35 consecutive seasons in the top three, 29 consecutive at least winning 21 or more, and 25 consecutive NCAA berths. With 13 wins and only 9 to play, I really believe they got to get to 17 and they will get in. 18 would be a lock, 17 would be a decision.
Certainly all of those streaks are in jeopardy. Boozer with a miss, Haywood down to the floor to keep it alive. No whistle yet, finally a tie-up. Possession arrow will give it to North Carolina. Third block of the game for Haywood.
You know, down 13, they made their little run now, got it into single digits. And there's Bill Guthridge doing a lot of work on that sideline. There's the block, he holds his ground, good defensive play by Brendan Haywood. Now he goes to the deck, he said, come on, give me the reward. So I'm trying to get a timeout.
You know, Dick, that the most amazing streak of all those is the 35 years in a row, first, second, or third in the ACC. You consider how strong this conference has been year in and year out. And for them to be first, second, or third
is amazing.
It's stunning because everybody else would be in this cycle where they'd have three great years, a down year, then they'd come back. North Carolina never had a down year. Will this be it? We'll find out. Duke holding on to an 8-point lead, 3:36 to go, first half of play. Duke has had the advantage through much of the first half. Cota trying to penetrate, leans into this one and missed the shot. Those are the opportunities where he normally excels.
Yeah, he really excels in the lane whenever he can get deep penetration.
Jason Williams maybe trying to be a little too fancy, threw it away.
You know a stat that really blows my mind in preparing for the game, Mike? They're averaging making 31 field goals a game, Duke, and they have 17 assists per game. Over 55% of their points come off a pass. Shows the unselfishness and the ability to share the basketball.
Cota trying to get it into Haywood. It's taken away by Boozer. They are really denying the middle.
They're jamming on the interior, as Brad said earlier. They put a lot of pressure on Haywood, making it difficult for him to get the ball. They do have to utilize some screens to free him.
Nice move by Williams to get inside, drops it off. The bucket counts in the foul.
I mean, that was a little delay action, but it does go down. I love Williams when he penetrates. He has great eyes. And to see his development from doing his first game when he played against Stanford, as we see the dump down, and there's the catch on the inside and the score. I mean, his development, he went out and looked at film of his first game and of his game against Wake Forest, and he said, I could see my growth as a point guard.
It's going to be three on Capel. Big call, and Capel will have to sit down at the 247 mark.
Well, you know, both clubs really not deep at all, so anytime you get a starter in foul trouble. In fairness to North Carolina, they were at one time preseason number two in America back in November of 29, and now struggling not being ranked. But early in the year, when everybody was rating them high, oh, look at the steal on the inbounds.
Tip, that looked like it was on the rim, and it was. Duke blows a golden opportunity to go up by 13.
But you know, I was talking a little bit about the fact that at the time when they were ranked so high in the preseason, they were talking about Ron Curry, burst sticker, as you see his hand interfering with the ball up on a cylinder. That's a no-no.
Also talking about Jason Parker.
Yes,
they
sir.
Thought they were going to have him.
And Vasco Eftimov went out and played in Greece.
That's
I mean,
right.
Four guys.
Cota, and when he penetrates, they have been very good about not dropping off of him and leaving other guys wide open. James, reach in, steal against Owens. Nate James, there's the quickness we talked about.
Stepped right into passing lane. Joseph Forte not really playing like a diaper dandy star tonight. They have cut off his game, and he made a bad pass right there.
12 turnovers against the Heels. Now they're down by 13. Lang goes baseline. Nice drive. Basket and the foul on Battier.
I tell you, Chris Lang has stepped up his game. He's very physical here tonight. Very aggressive. And they need him. Last year, he had a big year for a diaper dandy, but he's had so many injuries, the shin splints, and then he had the flu and all kinds of illness. There he is with the jam.
Dick, if he could come up with that 15-foot jump shot, he'd be the whole package, wouldn't he?
Exactly, but he's got that great jump hook with either hand on a baseline.
First foul on Battier, laying way short on the free throw, knocked out of bounds, and it's out to Duke with 2:06 to go. Lang has missed all three free throw attempts tonight. He's a good free throw shooter.
Hey, you know, you talk about Duke and all their diaper dandies, how stupid they are. You remember this name, Chris Duhon, coming here next year from Louisiana. Just what they need, another superstar.
I'm going to say, they need more?
They'll keep getting more, too.
Good pass inside, then to kick it back outside, and Carwell buries.
There's the unselfishness.
Battier, excuse me.
There's the unselfishness, always making the extra pass, and that's why over 55% of the points come off the pass.
Tried to force it into Haywood. Battier picks up the loose ball. Battier already with 14 points in the half.
And Duke going in with some momentum, it looks like, at halftime. Looked like North Carolina was cutting back, but now looks like Duke is taking charge.
Three-second call against the Blue Devils as Carwell was in the process of maybe getting away with a travel.
Duke has won 58 games in a row against unranked teams. Back in 1990, they played North Carolina. They were unranked. Duke was ranked. Carolina beat them twice that year in 90.
And that's a story in itself, the fact that North Carolina is unranked. They've gone 172 straight weeks in the polls, most of that in the top 10.
That's about
a poor pass by Forte.
Yeah, he's struggling, Mike. He is really not in it. I think you got to take him out for a moment.
Williams, pull up three. He's just cold-blooded. Williams drains another one, and it's 39-24.
He certainly has won the battle on the point guard slot tonight. He's not playing like no freshman, I'll tell you that.
He has dominated. Cota with six turnovers in this ballgame, and Forte starting to force things. And Duke has done an excellent job on the boards, the one thing they were really worried about.
I tell you, Duke has really amazed me. Having them earlier this year when they lost those two games, but people didn't realize the critics were beginning to smile that are anti-Duke. They lost to Stanford, and they lost to Connecticut. I mean, we're talking two of the premier teams in America. And both were games they could have won.
And tonight they are going for their 17th in a row and their 30th in a row in the ACC. Dunleavy for three, doesn't get an offensive rebound and a foul with 17-6 to go in the half.
Hey, Brad, I want to go to Brad Daugherty right now as we look at the streaks right here, Brad. I'll get to you in a moment. 58 wins against unranked, 29 straight in the ACC. 15 on a road is unbelievable and 16 consecutive wins. But, Brad, I want to get to you right now. It seems to me, when I look at North Carolina, they're all standing around waiting for somebody to give them a lift. Where are they going to get that lift?
Dick, as I've watched North Carolina play this past year, the one thing that they have not done very well is start the basketball game with a lot of intensity, getting a lot of shots off. It's as if they came out tonight trying to put the basketball up to get some momentum, and now it's all died. They have to continue to be aggressive. Ed Cota's going to have to push this basketball up, try to create some opportunities because they're just standing. Brendan Haywood's trying to post up. He has three guys back in his lap, and they're forcing the ball in, turning it over.
And then Carwell, Brad, did a super job shutting down Forte.
He's done a great job on Forte, as well as Battier has guarded Brendan Haywood at times, showing his versatility.
Biggest lead of the game, almost another steal. The Heels just save it and trying to force the shot at the buzzer. They nearly got a desperation shot, but a big run by Duke at the end, and they've opened up a 17-point spread. The number three team in the nation visiting North Carolina. That's our story from Chapel Hill.
ESPN2's exclusive presentation of NCAA basketball presented by America Online is brought to you by Mitsubishi Motors, the 2000 Gallant. Wake up and drive.
North Carolina, and when you take a look at the first half stats, you will see why. They dominated every single area. Field goals, 50-38. Free throws, 7-none. Steals, 10-1. Only six turnovers. They forced Carolina into 14. And Ed Cota, the point guard, only 1 out of 6 from the floor. He has 6 turnovers against a terrific defense. Duke with the lead, back in a moment. Duke on top of North Carolina, 41-24. We told you two of the keys would be Cota and Haywood. They have been shut down entirely in the first half. And when you talk about Duke basketball over the years, you always end up talking about defense, no matter how well they play on the other side.
I tell you, you talk about the minister of defense, you talk about Shane Battier and certainly Carawell, but Battier offensively was outstanding as well. We're going to watch him right here operate turn and face in triple threat position and show he can drill the J. I mean, just a great play. Now we see a little penetration here. And we're going to watch him right here with the deflection. He does a great job defensively. The deflection kicks it out to Jason Williams, and Williams finishes it off. But, partner, you said it best. When Ed Cota, the senior, has 6 turnovers in a half and has only 1 field goal, you know they're in trouble. And Brendan Haywood, the 7-footer, has 1 touch inside, basically, in terms of offensively. He's taken 1 shot. How are you going to win with Cota and Haywood not giving you zilch?
Plus, Haywood gets 1 rebound, wow. So he hasn't contributed in that department. And I think it just shows you how dominant Duke is because of the quickness we talked at the beginning of the game. Their defensive quickness has forced 10 turnovers. They get a lot of easy baskets. Carolina gets no easy baskets.
No easy baskets. That's why it puts pressure on them to execute in their half-court game. Their offensive efficiency has to be so high. And then you look at the free throw line. Duke goes to the line, converts 7 times. Carolina's got 0. And that means they're not playing aggressive. And then another stat jumps at you, shows trends and tendencies. You look at the steals. Carolina with 1 steal, Mike, and you look at 10 for Duke. That means Duke is the aggressor.
Brad Daugherty talked about Boozer early in the ball game and before the ball game. What about his performance so far, the freshman, Brad?
Well, Mike, the freshman has been unflappable inside, using a good, wide, strong base to knock Brendan Haywood around. Brendan's retaliated, but Boozer's getting excellent help from the backside from probably the best defender in the whole league in Shane Battier. Tough matchup inside. Boozer's doing a great job. They got to free up Haywood a little bit more. He has to be a little more active to give himself an opportunity.
Hey, Brad, you've been in the locker room in North Carolina. What would be the locker room right now with the presence of Bill Guthridge, a low-key kind of coach?
Well, once you get into the locker room, Coach Guthridge is going to offer a lot of positives. He's going to point out the good things that they're doing, and he's also going to tell them of the things that they need to improve upon in this second half in order to put themselves in the position to win. They're not putting themselves in the position. If you take a shot, a good shot, you miss it, that's fine. But if you're forcing the basketball, forcing bad shots, that leads to losing the basketball game.
And certainly, Brad, we have seen Forte force some shots. And then Cota got a lot of those open shots. And I thought it was fascinating what Duke did defensively against Ed Cota. We talked about how last year they had developed a theory they would back off ever so slightly on Ed Cota. If he did penetrate, he wouldn't get a good look. And they're not going to drop off and leave the other guys open. If Cota is going to hurt him, he's going to have to score from inside.
Well, you know, he hurt them big time. Remember last year at Duke, he had a great performance for 30 minutes, and then he got hurt, but he was beating him with dribble penetration. Tonight he's not beat. That is unbelievable. What a way to come out to start the half.
Battier has 16 in the ball game, and the lead is 19 points.
You know, we found out that he could score last year. Remember the game against Maryland where he stepped it up? Gary Williams remembers it.
Boy, there's this shot by Capel. It just goes over everything. And then a loose ball inside knocked out to Duke.
You know, poor Gary Williams mentioning Gary. He said, it's my luck that there's a snowstorm and that the fans can't
That's
get in
right.
and the kids get on the sideline and they get all that momentum. He had a great performance, by the way, last night against Virginia. They really played well, Maryland.
May have been their best ball game of the year, and certainly before the season is over, they'll be heard from. Battier cut off. This is Carawell, so dangerous, short on the jumper, and the rebound goes to Joseph Forte. Cota, pull up for 3. Got it! That's what they need to get them started.
They need to start with their defense as well. They got to try to force a turnover or two. They may have to take a few gambles defensively.
If you're a North Carolina fan, the last couple of games, they have been so much better in the second half. And we have seen so many miracles on this court.
Well, you know, the one that amazes me, and I was not here, Mike. I don't know if you were. I was not. When they were down 8 with 18 seconds to go and 1, that still blows my mind when I hear that with Walter Davis and company and Bobby Jones, 8 with 18 seconds.
I did not get to see that game in person.
You heard about it, right?
Oh, absolutely.
That's hard to believe.
Lang so quick with that jump hook, but he misses.
Right now, Duke has to be careful and not playing the clock and really worrying about they got the big lead. They just got to continue to play and not get conservative.
Battier beyond the arc. He's got Haywood out on him. Carawell matched up with Forte. Good physical matchup for Carawell. Doesn't get the roll, then Nate James knocked it out of bounds. I remember the huge comeback against Florida State, down by 19 with about 9 minutes to go, and Florida State, they had a terrific ball club.
Yeah, I remember that. You and I were here also one time. They had a big, big performance against Maryland with a comeback.
Oh! Haywood, nice move to get free inside, and he's fouled.
He is so effective if he gets touches inside, recognizing when he's open, but he has to learn to just be a little bit more active, and they got to do a little better job screening to get him free on the interior. There he is with a good drop step. He's got some really nice moves inside. There he is, that nice little post move. Looks a little bit like our Brad Daugherty when he was going to the glass. With the help of his friends, Mr. Jordan, Mr. Perkins. Very quiet. The one thing that's happened here tonight, North Carolina doesn't want to happen, is the fact this crowd is so silent. You look here at Mr. Haywood, 2 points here in the second half.
And he misses both free throws.
They look mentally beat right now, and that's a sad state to see a bunch of kids. They really don't look like they have that fire, like they believe they can come back.
Well, those free throws are huge. Those are shots you have to make, and those wide open shots are ones you have to make. The follow by Haywood won't go, and then Capel tries it. Haywood again. Got it.
Well, at least four opportunities, Mike. That shows a little aggressiveness. At least they're a little bit active right there. They got to get a spark. They got to get a player to get a little emotional out there and really get them charged up.
And Mike Krzyzewski is going to get Christensen right back in the ball game for his bulk inside. This one's knocked out of bounds out to the Blue Devils.
See, I really believe when you play at North Carolina, when you play football at Notre Dame, you play more than you do for yourself. You play for tradition. You play for pride. You fight and you scrap like they're doing right here. Because, Mike, those schools, they bring so much tradition and pride, and that uniform represents more than just you wearing it.
Dunleavy kicks it back outside for the three. That is a killer, 46-29.
And that's exactly Duke basketball at its best, if you have to define it. Penetrate and kick it out to the open shooter. I mean, even our guy Feldman in the studio and Katz, they can make that, those two guys in the backcourt. I mean, great penetration and a kick out. We're going to see it right here. We're going to watch it. Freeze it right there. See, he gets right in the gap, and then he's going to kick the ball out. He kicks the ball right out, and there it is to the open shooter. But it's all caused by dribble penetration, getting three people to him.
And Carrawell shoots nearly 43% from the outside. Another miss for Ed Cota. Not his night so far.
You know, I think that Battier and Carrawell are so good. You can take our guy Dave Feldman and our guy Andy Katz and even myself or you and put us out there with those two, and we got a chance to win.
You mean or me?
I saw you shoot one time.
Hey, I grew up in West Virginia. I can shoot it. I just never learned to pass.
Well, I know you love your boy, the Cabin Creek superstar, Mr. West.
Cota brings it down into a 17-point lead. Forte, the freshman.
They have such a difficult time finding a way to get a spurt.
Carrawell has just eaten him up tonight.
Oh, he's just locked him up. He forced the 5-second count there. Forte has not seen defensive tenacity like he's seeing tonight. And he's not the only one. Ask Mr. Grundy. Ask Mr. Hale of Florida State. They have all faced this kind of defensive pressure from Mr. Carrawell. And they have all been locked up. He's the Yale man, man. He just locks you up.
Carrawell, the senior who did not leave, wanted to come back, have one more shot with this ball club.
And guys like Kenyon Martin and Carrawell, their stock keeps going up and up. Very intelligent by coming back to school.
Williams got it to Christensen. He sets the screen. Williams with a miss. And a foul against Duke. Looked like Dunleavy over the back.
I talk about great freshmen. If I had to talk about my impact freshman, Jason Williams would be in here. There's no doubt about it. Along with Jason Gardner. You think about guys like Lavelle Blanchard as well from Michigan. Yes, it's been all Duke.
It was the spring Mike Krzyzewski would rather forget. First, they lost the Final Four to UConn. Then Mike had back surgery in April, and then came the rapid departure of his star underclassman. Elton Brand goes. William Avery decides on the 15th to enter. Chris Burgess transfers. Of course, he lost Trajan Langdon to graduation, and then Corey Maggette enters the NBA draft. And on top of that, came an article that I was really disappointed in ESPN, the magazine, that characterized Mike Krzyzewski as something. I've known him 20 years. I have never known the man who was in that article. I don't believe it for a minute. And I thought he really got the short end of the stick on that. This is one of the most principled, honest, decent people I have ever met. And I don't buy that article one second.
I'll tell you one thing, Mike. We need more coaches like Mike Krzyzewski on the sideline. He's an intense competitor. And one thing he is, he's very honest and very candid. He did not feel that William Avery should have went to the NBA. And you know what? He was right. William Avery is sitting day after day on the pine when he could have been a major contributor right here and his stock would have went up. Mike is a very honest guy. And I'll tell you something else about him. I've got to know him a little bit more off the court. And his love for people and for people that are struggling. I've seen what he's done
with
the V Foundation. He's a very special guy.
Dunleavy picked up his second personal on that one. Duke has committed 16 fouls in the second half. Carolina yet to be whistled for one. They're down still by 17.
Cota trying to penetrate.
Duke still playing that tough man-to-man defense. Making him really work for every shot.
Haywood, that's a tough pass. Lang is not going to catch that 3 out of 10 times.
Well, they did a great job running and cutting off Haywood, making it difficult for him to get to the basket.
16 turnovers from North Carolina. Duke forces nearly 20 a game.
And the turnovers really have been a nightmare when you talk about them as you look at the number here for North Carolina. In those four games they lost in a row, they averaged about 19 turnovers a game in those four. And then force men.
Jason Williams trying to penetrate. He's fouled by Cota. That's number one on the senior, who is third all time in the ACC in assists. Tomorrow night at 9, ESPN's Outside the Lines, presented by AT&T, takes an in-depth look at gambling in the Super Bowl. From the company that makes the opening line for most Vegas sports books to the behind-the-scenes look at law enforcement's annual war on sports betting. For more, you can log on to ESPN.com, part of GoNetworkGo.com. That is a great series.
Well, Bob Lee does a phenomenal job.
Doesn't he? He's just sensational.
Yes, he does. You know, it's amazing with Carwell. He never scored 20 points in a game in his first 3 years. This year, he's had 9 games already over 20. How's that for improvement?
He has been sensational.
And his buddy playing now for Arizona, Lauren Woods, has been sensational. They both played in high school together at Cardinal Ritter High School in St. Louis.
Forte tossed up an air ball from 6 feet. I think expecting defensive pressure, didn't get any.
He's not playing with any confidence, Mike. Not the kid that we've seen so many times. I mean, he's a blue chip talent. He's a PT peer. The kid has got a world of talent, and he's going to be a special Carolina player. But he seems like he's a half step slow tonight.
Haywood double team. Cota wheels into the lane.
That's where he's at his best. If the Brooklyn kid can get into the lane, penetrate, just ask Herb Sendick. He went 8 for 8 against North Carolina State.
Oh. Dunleavy, holy cow, what a move!
And his dad jumps up and says, "That's my boy." Everybody knows his dad, one of the outstanding coaches down the NBA.
And look at the hustle on defense. Duke nearly turns it over. The lead is back to 19, and North Carolina running. Forte gets the lay-in.
Nice look by Cota. Well, what a nice drive. Driving the baseline with the reverse layup by Dunleavy. We take a look at Dunleavy right now. There he is with that little reverse layup, hanging in the air, gliding. Oh, nice little reverse. He's going to be special.
Goes right past the 7-footer. Another freshman. He's out of Lake Oswego, Oregon.
He grew up around basketball. Ball boy with the Lakers when his dad coached there. What a team they got out in Portland.
Whoa. That time, Jason Williams airmail one into the fifth row.
I say, Mike does a really blue chip job rotating the 6 players, making sure that they can all get their minutes a little bit on the sideline as well. But you know what makes their 6 so unique? They all can play about 3 different positions, basically. They have so much versatility. There's a look at Krzyzewski on the sideline. Wojciechowski sitting there.
Well, tonight he's got some minutes out of Christensen, also a couple out of Horvath off the bench. So really, he has gone 8 deep, but those aren't quality minutes for those guys most of the time.
No, those are like minimal minutes. He's just getting them to just give somebody a break. It's the big 6 that's really the group that has carried this club to where they are today.
13:45 to go in the game, and they try to get inside to Dunleavy, and he is pushed from behind.
And every time I look at their numbers, I begin to shake. When you think this is the ACC, I mean, this is not just another conference. To win 29 in a row in the ACC, Mike, and the last time they lost was February 5th, 1998, and it was on this floor when it was the Carter Jameson Show. And it was a beating. You and I were here, 97-73. Yeah.
Jason Capel just picked up his fourth personal foul with 13:44 to go in the ballgame.
Well, one thing about Jason, Eddie Kidd plays hard all the time.
Dunleavy off the Williams feed. Williams offensive rebound. Hayward clears.
Look at the job. They always get back. They always neutralize the running game.
Forte knocks it outside. Nothing going for Carolina. And then Duke throws it away at the other end.
See, a great job that Mike's club does is the balance they have in getting back defensively. You look at his coaching staff, they all wore the Duke uniform. Henderson, Dawkins.
Cota. Second time in a row he's been able to get inside and score.
Yeah, if he can get into that lane, he's so effective. He's starting to get some deep penetration.
Ed Cota has 10. He is the only North Carolina player in double figures.
And the crowd's standing up. They know if they can get a little spurt here, get about the 8-minute mark, get it down to about 8 or 9, they got a shot.
It's 15 right now. Carroll usually wants the big shots just like that.
Well, a lot of guys want the big shots but can't convert the big shots. Yeah. He can convert them, especially if he gets that 15-foot range.
13 for Carroll. Forte leans into Dunleavy. He got the bucket and drew the foul. Not sure how he did that one. That'll be 3 on Dunleavy.
Gonna take a look right here at Joseph Forte. There he is driving to the goal. Gets the conversion, takes Dunleavy, two diaper dandies going head to head. He's saying, hey, Dunleavy, anything you can do, I can do better. And Dunleavy says, yeah, but look at the scoreboard.
Another very bright player, misses the free throw.
Came out of a great program, DeMatha. His buddy, Keith Bogans, went for 25 the other day in a big win for Kentucky over Tennessee. They both played together.
Dick, North Carolina is 0-for-6 from the free throw line tonight. That's not North Carolina basketball. Nice rebound to Forte. Cota would like to find Haywood. Can't get it into him. Forte left alone for 14.
He's stepping it up. He's stepping it up now. There's a little bit more confidence.
Forte now into double figures. The lead is cut to 13. The crowd back on its feet.
He can put a lot of points on the board quickly. And Brad, all of a sudden, it looks like Forte is starting to get into the flow.
Yeah, we talked about Joseph Forte, how he starts slow. The whole team starts slow. And as the basketball game in the second half gets into the waning moments, it seems like they step up. But he's really starting to find a rhythm. Carwell's done an outstanding job on him tonight. Really has shut him down. But he's starting to move. Keep pressing, looking for your opportunities, and they'll come.
You know, Brad, that is always one of those things. When a team starts slow, you ask the coach what you can do, and normally they've tried everything and nothing works. You start slow, well, you start slow.
Yeah, exactly. Mike, you know what happens when a team starts slow, especially like North Carolina? What happens is they come out and they try to run their offense to precision. And sometimes you over-focus, you hyper-focus, and you overextend the play. And before you know it, you have to take a tough shot. You don't get a good opportunity.
Yeah.
You got to react. It's a reaction game.
I'll tell you right now, they got to come up with a couple of defensive stops, and they could psychologically get back in this game. 13 and with 11 minutes to go. I mean, they're right within a situation of getting back right now. You feel a little bit. The crowd is dying to get into it. I mean, this crowd is really trying to get in it.
The lead has been cut from 19 to 13. I was just going to say, you're either going to see Carroll or Battier take the shot off of this inbounds play, and Battier just drains a three.
Every time they're in trouble, one of those two step up. That's why I wrote in USA Today, I've said on TV, you give me two guys as a combination who understand the role of winning. I want Mr. Battier and I want Mr. Carroll.
Battier has 19.
We're going to see the defensive transition of Duke. We watch right here in this sequence. There's the little jump shot. North Carolina comes out with the rebound, and now they're in position to kick it out and run. But take a look right here. We see it. Freeze it right here. Look at this. All five guys. Everybody back. They're up protecting the basket. They're going to make them kick the ball back out. Look at the super job. All five guys make them kick the ball back outside. All by hustling and scrapping and defensive transition, getting back defensively.
You look at the two stars on each side. Battier and Carrawell have combined for 32. Haywood and Cota for 14. And look at the numbers. Battier, 7 out of 8, 7 boards, and the terrific defense that he plays every night. The same for Carrawell. He's chipped in with 13.
See, that's what makes them special. They play defense. They take charges. They scrap for loose balls. They offer verbal leadership as well. And they're such great kids that everybody has such respect for them.
The lead is 16. Boozer misses the shot. Good rebound to Peppers.
I'll tell you one thing. Peppers very agile and mobile. And sometimes he can be very hostile.
Lang with that jump hook.
That's what it matters if he gets it in that deep. He sits in that post, gets it in that deep.
The problem has been they can't get it to him very often. He only averages 8 points a game. Once again, they've cut it to 14. Will it be Carrawell or Battier that takes the big shot as it gets closer? Battier, bodies fly, no whistle.
They got to get a score out of this. They got to get a score. Fill the lane and get a score.
Cota!
There it is. They got to get a score, Mike. They can get this into single digits. This place will rock. This crowd wants to come alive. They say, let's go, Heels. Let's go. Let's get up.
North Carolina has hit its last 5 shots to make it a 12-point lead. The rebound goes to Capel.
This could be interesting, Mike. They seem to have a little better bounce to their game, especially this guy. Mr. Cota made a great decision in a previous possession.
They get it to Lang. That's automatic.
Great execution. They reverse the basketball. They swung it side to side. They got it to 10. This baby is not over. This baby is not over.
They cut it to 10 at 10:01, and Mike Shefsky wants to talk about it. A 19-point lead has gone down to 5 buckets.
You know, sitting and watching this very coolly right now is Virginia. They got Duke on Saturday. Brett Musburger, my buddy, and I will be over there for that game. And I'll tell you, emotionally, Duke coming out of this game, that's going to be a tough game getting ready to play in less than 36 hours. Take a look at Ed Cota. Now he shows his senior leadership right here. Kicks it out, gets it back, and there's the little left-hand layup. Lang on the inside after they reversed the basketball, swung it side to side. Hey, Brad, you've been a heck of a player on a collegiate and professional level. So many good things happen when you reverse the ball from side to side.
That's exactly right, Dick. You break the defense down when the ball goes to the weak side. There's a full rotation defensively, and a lot of teams, Duke is one of the teams that will make it, but a lot of teams don't want to make that extra effort.
And whenever Lang gets somebody on his back, he's going to score.
Like, this crowd really is ready to give them a big lift if they come up with a stop.
Carrawell knocked out of bounds, out to the Blue Devils. They thought it was off Battier in the crowd.
Can this be one of the Carolina miracle runs during the Dean Smith era? There were many of those special moments. I miss seeing Dean. I'll tell you, I really do. Not to take anything away from Bill Guthridge, but I miss seeing the Michelangelo of coaching.
A rare steal.
Oh, he got to knock it down.
Cota wide open.
Yes, sir. This is going to get interesting, Mike. You can feel it. Up the ball is here at Chapel Hill. Up the ball has arrived.
They've cut it to 7, and I'll tell you what, Uncle Mo better play defense on this trip. North Carolina's hit its last 7 shots.
That's why they lead the nation in field goal percentage. What a
basket and the foul, and guess who? Carrawell.
I mean, you can close your eyes and make the call.
Just a knife to the heart when they need it.
Especially when a team is making a run. This is why he's my choice as the most valuable player in the ACC. Anytime they need a big play, he has just stepped up, like my partner said. He responds to the challenge.
Go for the 3-point play for Mike Krzyzewski.
Mike saying, run that clock, baby. Let that clock begin to move.
So Cota hits the 3 at one end. And Carrawell comes back with an old-fashioned 3 at the other. The lead is back to 10.
You know, you think the significance of this game, if you're North Carolina, you're 13-9 now with only 8 to play. And that puts pressure to win 5 games. And you got a trip to Duke. I mean, this is almost like a double L if you lose here.
I was just going to say, you get to play him again at Cameron, the last regular season game of the year.
And you think the Cameron crazies will respond? You know, everybody's trying to emulate them, Mike, everywhere I go. But they're the real deal down here at Cameron Indoor Stadium, right on the floor.
Here's a reach-in foul. Going to be called on Nate James. That's his fourth.
Nate James can't believe the call. Can't believe it. I tell you, the one thing that Mike does a phenomenal job of, he has short-term goals, long-term goals, and is constantly motivating with certain little goals for each player. He keeps them so motivated. The kid that really I thought would have been special here this year, transferred to Utah, was Chris Burgess. I thought his size and his talent and ability would have been special this season had he been patient. But they love him out at Utah. In fact, Rick Majerus told me, he said, I really like his progress.
The Tar Heels looking for their first free throw and finally get it.
That's amazing.
8 minutes and 59 seconds to go in the ball game. Brad, what do you have for us?
Dick, I've got a question for Dick Vitale.
Uh-oh.
This is, I want to see how good your knowledge of basketball really is.
It's not too good now.
Which team is the winningest team in the ACC during the 90s, including the ACC tournaments?
Well, including that, I'd have to definitely say, it's got to be, I know you're setting me up, you think I'm going to say Duke, but it's North Carolina.
That's exactly right, Dick. Very good, very good.
But the team in the 90s is the Dukies. They're winning those national titles in 91, 92, and the trip to the Final Four, and almost win it again last year.
Hey, Brad, how come I thought you weren't going to come up with the Duke answer? Nice offensive rebound by Battier. A fresh shot clock, 8:36 and counting in this game.
I tell you, Mike, managing the clock becomes big.
Dunley, we switch to the left hand. It's knocked out of bounds. It's out to Duke.
And the one thing you have to really appreciate, I'll be honest, you and I didn't see a real spark out of North Carolina, and they could have been really tucked away big time when they were down 17. But they got it down to 8 with 8 minutes to go, and they got to feel like there's a chance now and really should give it that little extra effort defensively.
They got it to Lang a couple of times. Here's Carrawell again. He's double-teamed as he wheels into the lane. Missed his shot. The rebound goes to Haywood.
See, right now, patient. I get a touch for Haywood inside. Because after a while, you know, he wears on you with that size. I'd get some reverse action, try to set him up with a screen.
Right now, Boozer is in on him.
He's leaning all over him, but I would try to set him up, but he's got a flash to the basketball.
Forte, who started to get hot here in the second half and has cooled off a little bit. 9 on the shot clock for Cota. Moves in with the left hand and has to dump it off. Excellent defense by Duke, and here they come on the run.
Nice pass.
Dunleavy gives it back. Excellent 2-on-1 to Carrawell.
They run that drill in practice every day. How to move the basketball when you're 2-on-1, stay a little wider than the lane, and make it difficult for one man to play you.
Another example of excellent defense setting up an easy basket.
And also unselfish basketball.
Absolutely.
How many times have we seen kids like that out of control driving to the goal?
Forte against the double team, but that left Haywood free for the follow.
Brendan Haywood with the big rebound on the interior, the big guy. Boy, I think of this program, and I think of Duke's program, 95-98, five players left North Carolina early. Stackhouse and Wallace and Jamison and Carter and McGinnis. And you think about the kids leaving last year for Duke.
Duke trying to spread that defense a little bit. Great feet inside to Boozer, and he is hacked as he goes up. It looked like Forte will get it cutting across.
Well, Carlos was a little bit slow taking it to the goal. He had the sure jam from out of Alaska. I'll tell you, Alaska's been very good to Duke with the Alaska Assassin, Trajan Langdon, and now Carlos Boozer.
It's a small pipeline, but a good one.
Tough break for Trajan Langdon. Had surgery and will be out the entire year. Beautiful kid, too. This guy's got a world of talent. As Brad said earlier, he's got great foot speed inside. He's got good agility. He's just got to get a little bit more tougher physically and emotionally and a little bit more aggressive to take him up to the next step as a player.
Boozer, the big freshman, the fifth best free throw shooter in the conference, hits them both. Duke turns defense into offense. One of the reasons they're on top of Carolina by 10 here at the Dean Dome. 62-52. Duke still by 10, 6:54 to go.
All right, hey, Brad, I got a question for you. You put me on a spot. I'm going to ask you right here. And you wore the uniform. Hey, what team has had, or what school in the ACC has had the most players drafted all time in terms of the NBA?
Oh, that's easy. That would have to be the University of North Carolina.
Oh, really? Oh, wow. Yes, sir. They had 83. Duke had 59. Carolina State 55 and Maryland 49. And you were one of the 83.
I'll tell you what, Dick, we've got this trivia covered.
Hey, loan me some cash, will you, Brad? I know you got that mega check coming in.
I'm just an old country boy, Dick.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, and you can afford to buy your own country.
This is Forte working against Dunleavy. Cota to baseline. Ed Cota's hit some big buckets down the stretch.
Nice pass by Forte. Early in the game, he was throwing a bad pass. Good two-man play between the backcourt combination. And again, it's 8 points. They got to come up with a defensive stop. Once they get it to eight, that's the closest they've gotten, Mike.
Cota has 17, 14 here in the second half.
Yeah, he and Forte have stepped up in the second half, played a lot better. Good defense right there to get the basketball back.
Carrowell was just trying to get out of the way, and he ended up holding onto the ball on baseline.
Now execution becomes really big with each possession.
6 minutes to go in the greatest rivalry in college basketball.
Nice drive. Nice drive. Nobody rotates over, and the Tar Heels are right back. He splits the defense, attacks the seam, and the Carolina faithful love it.
This is as close as they have been. The shooting percentages really turned around. Fight for it inside, and jump ball or a foul?
If it jumps,
it's a foul.
Haywood said, hey, young guy, don't bring that rock into the lane. Thou shalt not enter my lane. There's Boozer trying to drop step inside, trying to attack the basket. There's Haywood with the great size and the good timing.
Forte will be charged with a foul, his third. And Boozer, you don't normally find a freshman big man with a great touch like he has, but he's hit three straight from the line here.
Mike, it's very difficult to catch them when you're behind, especially if you put them on a free throw line. Their top six players shoot better than 70%. Tonight, they're 13 for 16 on the line.
And are by far the best free throw shooting team in the ACC. But the lead is only 7.
And Snowden's got a real step now to his game that we didn't see in the first half. He's got that shake and bake.
Cota trying to get by Williams, had to pick up his dribble. Forte.
Good move to get three at the baseline. He's become much more aggressive offensively, and he's got more confidence, and it's slowly creeping, baby. It's down to 5. Could this be the end of 29 in a row? Remember the Dukies. The last time they lost to the ACC was right here in February of 98.
Forte has a dozen. Carrowell again taking the big shot. This one won't go for him. Haywood rebound.
It doesn't go down. You know what I like about North Carolina, Mike? They've never tried to rush the action. They stayed within their offense.
Lang, jump up with the right hand. He lost that ball on the way up and kept it alive. Had it partially blocked. Haywood has blocked the foul.
Lang should have given that up. He had a great passing opportunity right to Haywood when the help came his way. The bench is standing. They got some life now. They got some life. Now look how aggressive they are playing. That's what happens when a few balls fall down for you. There's Lang working on the inside. Now here comes Haywood over with the catch. Draws the contact.
You know, I don't think either one of those shots by Lang was blocked. It looked like they just slipped out of his hand.
Down to 4, Michael. Down to 4, Michael.
Haywood now 7 points, 9 rebounds. Lang will get a breather. Remember, he had that viral infection 10 days ago, lost a lot of weight, was very tired. Haywood has hit 1 out of 3 from the line, misses the second. These are huge with 4:38 to go in the game.
Well, Duke has really come up short in their last few possessions. They got to come up with a big play right here.
Right down the lane, the freshman.
Are you serious with that drive to the goal? I mean, he just went to the basket with authority. He's got great body strength.
What explosiveness. Cota had it partially blocked. Haywood with a foul.
That's Haywood hanging around the rim with the jab.
The big guy has really come alive.
Remember, people, 29 in a row the Dukies had. 58 in a row against unranked teams. Carolina playing for pride, trying to salvage something this year after a disappointing start.
The lead is 4. Nate James out of the corner for 3. It's an air ball rebounded by Duke, and a foul underneath as Battier got the air ball right in his lap.
Yeah, that's a play you got to come up with, North Carolina. The air ball situation, you got to jump up for that ball. You're down four. Look at Brendan Haywood now. He's hanging around the inside, the seven-footer. He's hanging around inside. He's got the great size. That was a concern of Mike Krzyzewski before the game in the locker room. He told me, he said, I'm really concerned with our ability to rebound against this club. He said, we are not, Dick, a real good rebounding team.
That was the fourth foul on Haywood. And if you want anybody to go to the line, if you're a Duke fan, it is Shane Battier.
He's like automatic on that line. Oh, we jinxed him. We jinxed him.
20 points, 10 rebounds. The lead is back to five.
This is a two-possession game only, Mike, with 3:48. There was a time this club was down 17, and they were struggling big time.
Forte, can he save it? He does. Now trying to make something happen. Cota with a chance to penetrate. Dishes it off. The jam, no good, and an offensive foul as Forte, or Peppers, came right down the lane a little bit out of control.
I mean, it's amazing to see a kid like Peppers on the floor at winning time when this guy reported to the team late. That's how thin they are on that bench.
And Shane Battier, who has taken more charges than anybody in Duke history, did it again. The proprietors on Franklin Street getting ready just in case. Can North Carolina break this streak? Duke has won 29 in a row in the Atlantic Coast Conference, 58 in a row against unranked opponents. Bill Guthridge and company would love to break that streak right now.
You know, Cota had a disastrous Mike first half. I mean, he was disastrous. 6 turnovers, only 1 field goal. He's now got 19 points and 7 assists. And Haywood, who had only 1 basket in the first half, is now 9 points and 9 rebounds. So they both stepped up big time.
Dunleavy on the run, missed the shot, but saved by the Blue Devils. Great hustle by Nate James.
Yeah, James with a good rebound right there to give him the second opportunity, but more than that, to take time off that clock. Managing the clock so big. Remember, these young kids have responded in an overtime game against Virginia and an overtime game against NC State. So watch the shot clock coming down.
This is Jason Williams.
He wants a screen up on top.
Oh, and Haywood with a big push, a silly foul on Haywood. He just came outside and flattened Battier.
Yeah, not a good play at all from up here, right in front of the officials. The clock winding down. You take a look at this up on top. Now watch the little play. I mean, how are you going to get away with that?
And Dick, that's 5. He just fouled out of the ballgame on that.
I mean, how smart is that play? Brad, I want to ask Brad down here. Brad, you're Mr. Haywood right now. You got 4 fouls. How could you possibly commit a foul like that in that situation?
What I would try to do if I'm Brendan Haywood is maybe try to show on that, step out and help the guard as he comes through the screen. He tried to push the guy out of the way give the guard enough room to get through. Step out and help. Show. Don't create that foul away from the basket. That's not a good foul at this point.
Yeah, exactly. The coaching terminology you used, I'm sure you had it with Coach Pacello and with your Cavaliers and Coach Smith, is hedging. You step out and hedge, but you don't make contact. I mean, he just put his hands all over it.
Battier's hit 5 out of 7 free throw, now make it 6 out of 8. Haywood is gone at the 250 mark with 9 points and 10 rebounds. Virtually all of that in the second half. He was held to 1 bucket, 1 rebound in the first 20 minutes of play.
I mean, just gave him an automatic deuce right there.
And you take your big man out of the ball game.
Mandatory possession. They got to get a score here, Mike. They need a score in this possession.
Forte picked up his dribble.
Yeah, that's a no-no. You never want for your young kids to just pick up that dribble on a perimeter.
Well, especially against defense like this. They just come all after you. Cota with a save in the corner. Nice feed to Lang, and Lang put it in.
I tell you, Lang has really moved a lot better tonight than I've seen him early. But what a great look by Ed Cota. Again, showing his uncanny ability to find the open man.
Lang has 10, but the lead is cut to 5. Pretty Cota now with 8 assists in the ballgame, but they're working on the clock.
Yeah, pretty tough to sit back in that zone like that, Mike, with that clock winding down. I mean, right now you got the clock winding down, and you got a 5-point deficit. You got to play a little aggressively defensively. I thought he shot the ball a little too soon right there. That's a mistake by a young player. You got to be a little bit more understanding of the clock.
Forte hustling down court, gets it to Cable for 3.
Celebrate, baby, on Franklin Street.
If you go back 2 years nearly to the day, 29 straight ACC wins ago, the last time Duke lost in the conference. Dick, we were here. It was quite a show because Duke had the North Carolina had the thoroughbreds. Jamison and Carter. Jamison was awesome. He just ate them alive inside.
He was awesome, baby. And I tell you, Mr. Carter as well. It was showtime and they celebrated. They blew the Dukies away that night. I mean, it was blowout city. Take a look at
the streaks. 58 wins against unranked opponents. In case you hadn't noticed, North Carolina unranked for the last 2 weeks. 29 straight in the ACC. 15 of those have been on the road.
And in 1990, North Carolina unranked beat Duke, who was ranked, twice in that season. Now we're going to see how Duke responds to the challenge put on him right now by Carolina. Hey, stay tuned, baby. Don't leave us. This is like the Super Bowl. Go right to the buzzer.
1:35 to go. A two-point lead for the Blue Devils. Defensive pressure by the Heels.
Patience, patience. You know their top two options want to shoot the ball. Carolina or Battier.
Feet inside. That was sensational to Nate James.
I tell you, awareness, just to have the awareness to find the open man.
Exactly.
That shows his value, Carwell.
Cota back the other way with the left hand. He missed, but Lang got the foul.
Chris Lang having his big day of the year. Really responded in a positive way on the interior.
That pass by Carwell, he was working so hard to get the shot. Finally saw he wasn't going to get it, and in just an instant, flicked it inside.
You know, Mike, we should have known better. You and I, we've done so many games, maybe 30 over the last 15 years between these clubs. And the bottom line, it was 17. It looked like it was going to be a blowout and not a lot of fun. But I'm telling you, we should have known better. Remember the one you and I did when Capel hit the shot to send it at the double OT, and it was 102-100. Carolina won that game. It was a brilliant performance. And tonight, again, it's going to come right down to the end. And remember this, if it goes to a buzzer beater, the officials must, mandatory, use the monitor.
By the way, the post-game press conferences will be live on ESPN News tonight, wow. So stay for those. And the one thing we always tell people, and it's the old cliche, throw out the record books. These teams don't like each other. The fans don't like each other. Brothers and sisters don't like each other if they're divided down the middle of the household.
And it went like that today when I was in the hospital visiting a bunch of patients at the cancer center here. One of the doctors said, hey, I can't tell anybody. I'm from North Carolina, but I'm here for Duke. I mean, it's you're right, Mike. Everybody gets after it. All right, here we go.
Carwell. Contact, no whistle, and he buries another huge shot.
He made the great pass, and then he makes the big shot. That's why, my friends, you spell his name MVP. MVP.
Reach in, out of bounds to North Carolina, but 36.9 ticks on the clock. There's 27 on the shot clock. And it is a four-point lead.
There he is, the little one-on-one. He regroups, squares his body, knocks it down, makes all the big plays. And remember this, if you're North Carolina, they're not playing for any moral victories. I can tell you that. They're not playing with that situation. Well, we played them tough because this will put them at 13-9, and this is a must game for them.
Cota nearly threw it away. This is Owens. Owens feeds underneath. The layup is good.
I see some good things out of Max Owens, but yet he seems to disappear for minutes. But he has ability to score, to penetrate, create opportunities.
North Carolina has only one timeout left, 24.8 seconds. Right now, it's still just a one-possession game. Nice job by Owens to get the pass to Capel.
Yes, he is. Driving again. There's that unbelievable move. Whenever you young people out there learn to dribble, drive, and penetrate, it creates opportunities, and that's what he did right there. And as Bill Guthridge, knowing how big this game is to his program, because it's been a struggle this year for North Carolina.
Rivalries usually mean the same thing all across the country. Look at the upsets. Oklahoma over Texas, although that is a mild upset. Kentucky over Tennessee. You have to consider if Kentucky beats Tennessee, that is a mild upset.
Well, you know,
and in the battle of the Titans in women's basketball, Tennessee upsets number one UConn. I tell you what, I'll take Sue Bird and four other people and go to war with you. What a great player.
Yeah, she can play, but what about that? Somebody in that locker room, she did a great job against an outstanding team.
Here's the full court pressure. This is not North Carolina's strong suit.
They want him to take some time off the clock. Now remember, they're excellent on a free throw line. That's one of the great pluses for Duke, the ability to convert on that free throw line. We talk about how big that is. Look at Coach K. He's been on a sideline in many a close game. 8 Final Fours, twice national champs, 91, 92. What a job he's done since his arrival out of the military academy in West Point. And right now they're hoping to get on that bus and head 6 miles away with 30 in a row in the ACC. 0 for 2 tonight.
Williams 0 for 2 from the line. Makes the first. If he makes the second, it is a two-possession game again. He has 10 points. The freshman has really played a good floor game tonight. Duke is at 17 out of 22 as a team. Carolina only 3 of 10. Williams misses. The rebound's to Cota. They can tie with a three.
They can tie with a three, Mike.
And they're going to need the three.
Perimeter defense right now. Duke extending on a perimeter.
Forte will have to take it. Got it! Basketball. What a clutch 3-point shot to send it in overtime.
And a diaper dandy. This is the way it's supposed to be. I have nothing to do until I see Mr. Musburger on Saturday. So let's stay here for about 7 overtimes. Oh, look at Joseph Forte. He's going to step up off the screen, squares his body, and he says, that's what my buddy Keith Bogans, who was big in that win for Kentucky over Tennessee, my partner. And there's the good defense. Tough shot.
Carowell got a pretty good look, but it wouldn't go. Tied at 73, we go to overtime.
He understands the clock and understands the situation. He's trying to set his man up to get the ball. Now, freeze it right here. See, he's going right under the basket. And now he's going to come all the way out for the basketball. Now, here he is right now, under the goal, comes all the way out right here. Freeze it right here. This little help by a screen here allowed him to get into this area to knock that shot down. Now there he is, knocks it down. Saw the open space, converted, but you gotta like any kid that's willing to take the big shot, especially a kid that struggled in the first half. Mike, remember, they were down 50 to 31 and looked like they were gonna be put away big time. We got to give them credit for the effort they did.
Absolutely.
To get into this overtime.
And still, they have never led in this ball game. They have a chance now. Forte, pull up three.
That's okay. I'll just tell you, Brad Daugherty gave a cheer down there. You know what? He's allowed to cheer for his alma mater.
Williams with a runner got the lay-in.
Heck of a shot. Heck of a shot by Joe Forte. I saw another freshman in 1982 hit a huge shot. Similar that, a little bit bigger than that, but that's a big one for Joe Forte.
Yeah, that was Michael the Magnificent to win the national title against the Hoyas.
Duke by 2 in overtime. Owens lost it on the way up, but a foul.
Now, this could be big, having Haywood. That foul really could hurt them in an overtime situation now, Mike, where he's on the sideline.
And if it's on Nate James, that's his fifth. He'll be gone, and it is.
And you got to remember, these clubs are very thin. You talk about Duke, their 6 guys play over 30 minutes a game. They rely so much on them. James, one of the unsung heroes on this basketball team, plays good defense, hustles, scraps. Kid that's had a lot of injuries in his career.
Owens, a terrific free throw shooter, hits the first.
He's got an offensive spark. He can provide that spark. What's his problem, Brad, this kid Owens? Because he shows some good ability.
Vic, I think he lost a lot of confidence earlier in the year. I think he felt a little threatened by Forte, and he didn't come out. He didn't keep looking for his shot. He kind of went into a shell, didn't take a lot of shot opportunities. He is in the basketball game to shoot. He's got a nice stroke. He can hit the three. He penetrates well. He just has to play with more confidence.
Right now they're in that zone, playing it very aggressively. Nice look.
Great ball movement by Duke. Williams fakes the shot and got it to Boozer.
I mean, that was just a great look. The two freshmen hook up. They really play so well together. Both guys have a great understanding. Good vision.
It was a clinic on how to move the ball.
Against the zone. Step right into the gap for the open shot.
Forte against Dunleavy. Leans in. Really forced that one. Lang with an offensive rebound, fouled by Boozer.
I'll tell you one thing, Bill Guthridge has got to be really happy with the effort he's getting out of a Lang. If he can give him that effort on a regular basis, they're going to win their share of games.
Well, I think Lang gives him that effort every time he's in there. He's just
physically.
Shin splints and a knee problem, and then he had the virus and lost a lot of weight.
You're
when
right.
When he's in there, he plays hard.
Yeah, you're right, Mike. I used the wrong terminology, just that he's getting a solid performance here tonight out of him.
13 points, 8 rebounds. That's his first free throw, though. He missed his first three.
I mean, they slowly crept back in this game to get it to overtime. Another miracle here because they looked like they were absolutely dead at 50-31.
Every possession becomes so huge. Duke leading by one, the nation's third-ranked team. They've won 16 straight, 29 straight in the ACC.
And 58 in a row over unranked team. The only team to beat them unranked in that stretch was Michigan.
Another great feed inside, and Boozer with another easy two.
Well, they've done a great job solving the open area in that zone. And remember, not having Brendan Haywood to deal with in that lane is certainly vital right now. And they're attacking that open area.
Duke has hit every shot in overtime. They have opened up a three-point lead. Lang wide open.
Great position by Lang. Held really well down in the post area. Got the good angle for the entry.
Easy shots for everybody because of excellent passing.
Yeah, excellent execution. Really doing the little things coaches teach to get free. There's that 2-3 zone. They're trying to overload a little bit against it on one wing side.
Well, they're backing off of Dunleavy.
See, now they're trying to overload. Get three against two.
There's the three by Battier out of the corner.
Shane Battier stepping up again with the big shot.
Battier has 25. And the lead is back to four.
But remember, Duke has won two overtime games, beating NC State and Virginia.
Cota had to force it up against three players. Maybe not the best decision, but great defense again by Duke.
You know, against Virginia, they scored in the first 10 possessions in the overtime. They'll have that rematch. It was 109-100. They'll have that rematch Saturday on ABC. Taking some time off the clock. See, there's that versatility. You have your guys that are playing the wings that can come out and play on the perimeter like Carawell.
Carawell, another great
same place.
Dish.
Same place again, though, Mike. They're attacking that one area that would be negated if Brendan Haywood was in that lane.
And you have to respect Carawell when he penetrates. You know he can bury that jump shot. So you come out on him, and he gets it into somebody else. 5 out of 5 from the floor for the Blue Devils in overtime. They have extended their lead to 6.
And, Mike, that's on top of going against Virginia when they scored in their first 10 possessions in overtime. There's the dump down to the inside. They got that seam. They got that recognized. They got that tendency. They find the open lane right down under the basket in the gap of that zone.
And if you're a big guy, this is like room service. I'm just going to hang around here until you find a way to get it to me because most guys don't miss those.
I'll tell you one thing. We got our two buddies that work with us. One is not here tonight, but one is. We got Jay Billis wherever he is. He's standing up, and he is cheering. And he's cheering for his Dukies. And I know Brad Daugherty's dying with every score. He's saying down here on the floor, I wish I was in that lane. There's no way they'd get that shot. Am I right, Mr. Daugherty?
I believe you may be right, Mr. Vitale.
You know, we need to get both Jay Billis and Brad Daugherty on the same telecast and put them down there together and see how it goes after
Let
a while.
Let them just play one-on-one.
Jay and I did radio today, and we had a very interesting conversation.
Duke, I'll bet you did. Duke has scored on every possession of this overtime. 5 possessions, 11 points. North Carolina has scored only 5. And with a minute 46 to go, North Carolina is back in the same position they were nearing the end of regulation. They need the big plays and then the big defensive stops.
What I'm really impressed by, though, is the fact that Duke can go to overtime. You and I did the game with NC State and then also that game with Virginia. When you really find out what these young people are like and they seem to respond offensively and defensively when the pressure is on top of them.
Coming up next, America's Cup Louis Vuitton Challenger Final, a race 7 America 1 versus Prada. The winner will hold a 4-3 lead in the best of 9 series. America 1 had trailed 3-1.
Marty,
1:46 to go.
Marty, who does a phenomenal job, our stat man, he just tells me, he says, Dick, in the Virginia game, Duke scored the first 9 possessions in overtime.
We are honored to have Mr. Aronoff join us this evening. It is a rare occurrence on the road.
He's a superstar at what he does. He's a PTP.
Forte, who was so hot down the stretch, hit the shot that sent it into overtime.
He better be a PTPer right now. They need that score.
On, missed the baseline pull-up. Look, Cota got the rebound. Cota got another one. And he got the follow.
And he converted. I tell you, Eddie Cota has been really outstanding in the second half. Had a really dismal first half, but he really responded here in the second half big time. He and Forte both.
84-80. 106 and counting.
Can't give any kind of score here, even on a free throw line. Any kind of score here would be a disaster.
16 on the shot clock. They spread the court. Bucket and the foul.
I believe it's over now, Mike. Unless we see one of those unbelievable, dramatic, miracle wins, that really can be the sealer right there, especially if they play on the defensive end.
Duke has hit every shot in overtime. Here's another cold-blooded shot by Carroll.
I mean, that's a big-time score. Yeah, defensive pressure all over him. Again, showing why he's my choice as the player of the year in the ACC. Chris Carroll. He made my Super Six All-American players as well.
Somebody asked him once why he liked it so much in at Duke. He said, when you grow up in St. Louis, gangs, drugs, drive-bys, you be at a place like Duke, you wake up every morning and you know why you love Duke.
Oh, you just walk that campus or walk here on the North Carolina campus. Both beautiful campuses.
87-83, 44.1 to go. North Carolina will use a timeout to set up their defense.
Again, Joseph Forte, King Joseph responds with a big trifecta. You look at the great players in America now, and it's great to see some of these kids like Carroll stay in school. Kenyon Martin of Cincinnati.
Absolutely.
Certainly has been sensational all year long. Khalid El-Amin down in Connecticut, who I think will bypass his senior year and go to the NBA draft.
Dick, I think you're going to see something really good for North Carolina, even if they don't come back to win in this overtime. I think this is going to give them a lot of confidence down the road.
Well, they need it badly, Mike. I know a moral victory is not going to make them happy. It sits about 13-9, but their next game is Clemson, and they should win that game, even though Clemson has shocked everyone. Larry Scheid's club, they blew away Georgia Tech the other day, and they blew away North Carolina State, so they must be improving.
Well, they had so many injuries early. I mean, it was incredible what they had to go through down there. Defensive pressure has got to come through here. A four-point lead.
You're looking at a two-possession game right now with 43 ticks on the clock.
Owens with a reach-in foul.
It'll stay at a two-possession game even if he converts the free throws. Bill Guthridge got a technical early, showed a lot of emotion. He knows the urgency of this game and how big it really is to his program. I mean, the critics were flowing big time, Mike. I mean, the radio talk shows, the newspapers, when they lost four in a row, it was like the end of the world here. I mean, they couldn't believe it.
If you were 71-22 in your first 93 games, would you expect anybody to be on your case?
You'd build a statue. Build a statue on campus and put you in a Hall of Fame.
Free throw does not go. They'll get another one with 43 seconds to go. A nice man, an outstanding coach, Phil Ford next to him. Bill Guthridge, they don't come much better than that. I'll tell you what.
He's a beautiful person. He's a great teacher. Loves the game. Loves the kids. Always has something positive to say.
Williams has struggled tonight. The free throw nine. He's a 72% shooter. He's hit only one of six, and it keeps the Heels alive.
And you don't have to think three here. Now get a quick deuce inside. Look to Lang.
Cota, great drive blocked from behind by Battier. Cota again can't hit it, and Battier with a rebound.
They had Lang inside down in the box, but they missed him down in the low post.
Boozer got the rebound. Check it.
Look at Shea Battier. He's laughing. He feels a lot better. His brother. What happened to his brother in that family? I can't believe it. I thought he had intelligence. He's playing and signed football for Duke. I saw he signed the other day to play football. A football player in the family. Play some hoops. Jeremy Battier signed for the Dukies.
26-6 to go. Capel has fouled out of the ballgame. 12 points and 9 rebounds. He played a long time with four. And Mike Krzyzewski trying to adjust his lineup.
I'm sure he'll have a light workout tomorrow after this game to get ready for Saturday afternoon. And Virginia. Virginia's got a really outstanding young group of kids. Travis Watson, who had 17 points, 16 rebounds against Duke. And Donald Hand, who's got superb quickness.
Orlando Melendez will check into the ballgame for the first time. The sophomore from Puerto Rico.
Have you seen Virginia? They scored 80 or averaging about 81 points.
Seen them
a game
on television. I tell you what, the coaching job they have done down there, Pete Gillen has been absolutely exquisite. What he with what he found there and what he has now.
Well, Chris Williams certainly gives him a big score on the wing. But they're coming up empty on the line. Usually they're automatic here late in the game.
And Boozer, who had been perfect at the line, misses this one. It is still a four-point ball game. They are holding out the lifeline to the Tar Heels.
Well, you don't want to foul here. You want him to take some time off the clock, play good, solid team defense. Don't allow penetration for a layup, but you don't want to foul.
Max Owens trying to draw the foul, leaned into the defender, and the officials weren't buying that one. Now a foul underneath with 16.7 seconds to go.
I'll tell you, Carroll and Battier, there's my deuce. Twosome, the winningest combination. They know the art of winning. Look at them tonight. 48 points between them, 15 rebounds, all kinds of defensive ability as well, and all the intangibles. Two bona fide big-time winners. They were role players last year. They're not role players now, Mr. Patrick. They have become stars.
Sensational. Free throw is good. The lead is cut to four with 16.7 to go. Our America Online players of the game, Carroll and Battier, will share it for the Blue Devils. Richly deserved. They've done a great job tonight. This would cut it to a one-possession game again. And now they're going to try to miss it and get it back. And they do. Melendez got the ball. There's the bucket. Now they can't stop it. No timeouts left. 10.8, two-point game. And they are going to foul Dunleavy with 8.7 to go.
Well, a good foul right there. The bottom line is Forte again making a great drive to the basket.
And Mike Krzyzewski was trying to get an intentional foul. And I think he had a point there. It was an outright push.
He wanted the intentional. He's talking to Duke Etzel. Come on, Duke. That was an intentional, baby. We got two shots in a basketball.
Dunleavy is a 74% free throw shooter, but he goes to the line for the first time tonight. And Cooley knocks down the first one.
He's got a great stroke. He's got that super stroke. They're ready to get on the bus, and they want to head 6 miles down the road with 30 in a row. 30 in a row in the ACC, an amazing number.
And it would be 17 straight this year after losing their opening two. Two possessions for the Heels. They have to hurry and hope for a miracle. The pull-up three won't go, and Duke survives in overtime at North Carolina. Mike Krzyzewski knows he got out of here just with his skin against Bill Guthridge. And Duke wins it in overtime, 90-86. It never fails to amaze us. This rivalry does it.
It's the greatest sports rivalry in all of college sports. I really believe that. I know the Army-Navy game, the Ohio State-Michigan football game, but this game for national implications is always so unique. And they're 3-0 now in overtime games, Mike.
For Brad Daugherty and Dick Vitale and our entire ESPN crew, this is Mike Patrick saying thanks for watching, everybody. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, go to the Go Network, go.com.